Almost all energy used by animals, fungi, and everything else is the energy of sunlight captured by photosynthesis in plants, algae, and cyanobacteria. Light intensity must be just right in habitats where sunlight is too intense, deserts, mountaintops. Plants often have hairs or spines that shade the plant. If light is too dim, in shady forest or deep in the ocean, not enough energy is available to allow life. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'm going to talk about the environmental factors that affect photosynthesis, such as light, leaf structure, and water. Photosynthesis is affected by the environment. From a plant's viewpoint, light has three important properties: quality, quantity, and duration. Quality of sunlight refers to the colors or wavelengths it contains. Sunlight is pure white because it contains the entire visible spectrum. During sunset and sunrise, sunlight passes through the atmosphere and a large percentage of the blue light is deflected upward. Consequently, light at ground level is enriched in red, which is easily visible. This period of red enriched light lasts only a few minutes and has little effect on photosynthesis. At noon, sunlight passes nearly vertical through the atmosphere and more blue light is transmitted. This is true of plants in deserts, grasslands, and the canopy of a forest. However, herbs and shrubs that grow near soil level in a forest are understory plants, and the light they receive has already passed through the leaves of the canopy. As light penetrates those leaves, red and blue are absorbed by chlorophyll, so the dim light received by understory plants is especially depleted in these critical wavelengths. They have extra amounts of accessory pigments, so they can gather the wavelengths available and pass the energy on to chlorophyll A. Similarly, algae that grow near the surface of lakes and oceans receive complete light, but water absorbs red and violet. Many kelps, brown algae, grow in deep ocean water and receive mostly green and blue light. Their accessory pigments absorb these wavelengths, therefore the kelps appear yellow-brown to us. Quantity of sunlight refers to light intensity or brightness. More light is available for photosynthesis on a clear than on a cloudy day. Understory plants receive dim light. Lower branches and branches on the shaded side of a plant receive less light. Plants growing in the shadow of a mountain or deep in canyons receive much less light than plants that grow on the slopes that face the sun. Plants growing near the equator receive intense light because the sun is always more or less directly overhead at noon, whereas plants near the poles receive very little light. Even during the summer, the sun is low at noon and light is scattered by the atmosphere. Think about how intensity of sunlight varies during the day and affects photosynthesis. Examine the solid line labeled 300 ppm carbon dioxide. The rate of photosynthesis was measured for plant growth under different intensities of light, but all with 300 ppm carbon dioxide in the air. The light compensation point is the level of light at which photosynthesis matches respiration. Plants grown for a long time in conditions below the light compensation point respire faster than they photosynthesize and starve to death. Near point A, those plants that receive dim light absorb less carbon dioxide, whereas those grown in brighter light absorb more carbon dioxide. Under normal levels of carbon dioxide, light is the limiting factor. At point B, plants received more light did not photosynthesize faster than those that received slightly less. In this case, limitation is carbon dioxide since photosynthesis went faster at higher carbon dioxide levels. At point C, the light was too intense and damaged the plant by overheating it and bleaching the pigments. These grapevines have abundant sunlight, water, and fertilizer. They could probably photosynthesize more rapidly only if more carbon dioxide were present. Light can become too intense, and in some plants in bright environments have developed adaptations to reflect light, such as thick trichomes or a heavy cuticle. While young, the leaves of Dusty Miller are completely obscured by trichomes, protecting the leaf from strong sunlight and insects. These cacti, Epithelantha, live in environments where sunlight is extremely intense. Their spines are so abundant and closely spaced that they shade the stem and prevent chlorophyll from being damaged. Plants of Dudleya Brittonii are protected from excess sunlight and water loss by a thick layer of white wax. This particular wax strongly reflects ultraviolet light. Understory plants of forests are adapted to low light. If a roadway is cut into a forest and plants adjacent to the cut are suddenly exposed to full sunlight, the shock may cause them to wilt and die. The duration of light refers to the number of hours per day that sunlight is available. At the equator, days are 12 hours long throughout the year. Farther north or south, days become longer in summer. Maximum length occurs near the poles, where the day is 24 hours long in midsummer and only night occurs in midwinter. In middle latitudes, winter days are short and sunlight is weak. Most plants can survive by means of stored nutrients. Even evergreen plants are unable to undergo much photosynthesis. However, because the temperatures are low, the plants are growing little and have a low rate of respiration. In many plants, longer days can cause greater amounts of photosynthesis. In others, chloroplasts become so full of starch that photosynthesis stops even though light is present. At night, starch is converted to sugar. The sugar is transported out of the chloroplast and can be used for growth or stored. By morning, leaf chloroplasts can resume photosynthesis. Given all this talk about the problems with light in the forest, how do wildflowers grow on a forest floor in temperate regions in early spring? The quality, quantity, and duration of light reaching the forest floor is highest in the early spring than in the summer after the leaves of the forest canopy have fully developed. Many wildflowers take advantage of the abundant light reaching the forest floor before they are shaded by the canopy trees. In hot, dry climates, plant leaf cells are packed closely without intercellular spaces. The small internal surface area retards evaporation. Cylindrical leaves reduce external leaf surface. In both cases, photosynthesis and growth slow because carbon dioxide absorption slows. These living stone plants of African deserts conserve water in several ways. They only have two leaves at a time. When two new ones form, the old two die. Not enough water is available for four leaves. The leaves are fleshy and pressed together, such that they form a cylinder with minimal surface area through which water can be lost. This is a plant of Haworthia cooperi. Its short stem is located several centimeters underground, and it produces many cylindrical leaves that are just long enough to reach the soil surface. The tips of the leaves visible here have transparent epidermis. And the mesophyll is also transparent because it has no intercellular spaces. Consequently, light enters through the window-like tip and then passes deep into the rest of the underground leaf, where cells with chloroplasts are located. Photosynthesis actually occurs underground. Because most of the leaf is subterranean, they stay cooler in the summer. They are less visible to animals, and the air in the soil is richer in carbon dioxide than is air above ground. This transverse leaf of aloe vera is so transparent you can read through it. It is excellent for transmitting light to parts of the leaf that are underground. The balance between water loss and photosynthesis is critical. Most plants keep their stomata open during the day. At night, carbon dioxide cannot be used, retaining water within the plant. If water stressed, stomata will close. This prevents entry of carbon dioxide and reduces photosynthetic activity. Light intensity exceeded the light compensation point for these trees just after 6 a.m. and photosynthesis increased rapidly. However, by early afternoon, photosynthesis dropped even though light and temperature were adequate. The problem was the lack of water stress. And probably stomata had begun to close around noon. On a cloudy day, water stress never became a problem, and stomata remained open. Even though there was less total light than in A, there was more photosynthesis for the day. In conclusion, light, leaf structure, and water can greatly affect the photosynthesis in a plant. I hope you have a better understanding of these factors.